All right, so we will go ahead and get started. We've got more folks that are on their way coming, and so we will welcome them when they get here. So, hi everybody. Thank you so much for coming today. Very excited because we are starting a new unit of our program. We're going to be talking about classic literature, and I know that means different things for everybody. So, if you have a piece of classic literature, something that is in the canon, something that was maybe inspired you to read, something you read in school, something you read for pleasure, please let me know because we can talk about it. I'm trying to make sure that we touch on a variety of genres and writers and authors during in this unit. So today is Austen Day, which is great. And I want to start the program with a disclaimer that I am not an Austen scholar. I do love her work. I read all six of her novels and her juvenilia and a lot of her influences. But it was quite a while ago, so probably like 10 years ago. So it was definitely time for a complete reread for me. I'm a different person than I was 10 years ago. So anyway, I look forward to all of us talking because I know some of you, I'm sure, know Austen's works way better than I do. So I can't wait to chat. Okay, so let's go ahead and start with Andrew's segment. Where's Andrew? Okay, so that looks like a nice place. Andrew, do you want to give us, do you feel comfortable giving us any hints?
Well, you've probably already guessed this point, but it is in England.
Yes, I figured. Well, Jane Austen, well, I don't, she was from Bath. Is it
This
around
is in
there?
Bath, England.
Okay.
Always near Bath, England.
It's near Bath. Okay. Is it a familiar, is it like a well-known place?
Well, we were talking about this yesterday, and I told Mom that today's theme was Jane Austen. She immediately guessed it. So
Oh,
I hope that's a good sign.
okay, we need to think. I feel like we can get this.
Notice we're not all jumping in, so
I know, I'm like,
all
we
pressure's
can
on
do
you,
it. We can
Joella.
do
Now, don't, yeah, everyone else jump in because I know you all know the answer.
Andrew, is it a personal library or is it at an institution?
It was a personal library. It is now an institution.
Ah, that is very
But
common. I wish I knew Bath better.
is it
Okay.
Jane Austen's family library?
Yes.
Yay, Steph, you win
I Googled
the
it.
prize. You Googled it. That's okay. I was gonna guess Jane Austen's library or something. I wasn't sure, but oh yay, okay. So you can, I did not realize you can go visit that place.
It is Chawton House, which was actually owned by her brother.
Oh.
The house itself built in 1580, and today it is the center for the study of early women's writing from 1600 to 1830.
Cool. So Steph,
Wow.
you win a free Marb magnet.
Oh, thanks.
Right, go ahead and take one. Cool.
Yay! Oh, that's so great. Thank you. That is perfect for today. So thank you, Andrew. Oh, and everyone, Andrew put the handout ready for download in the chat so you can learn more about that place. And can you say the name one more time again, Andrew?
Button.
Okay. Wonderful. Thank you. Okay, so since we're already talking about Jane Austen, let's continue. I'd like to add in a few links from a few links in the chat. And these were because for those of you who are familiar with Jane Austen and her work, you're also probably familiar that she almost has like a following and has had one for hundreds of years. And so there's the, I'm putting this in the chat, the Jane Austen Center in England. And then there's also, I don't know if they call themselves this, but I've been calling them JASNA, Jane Austen Society. of North America. I'm putting this in. So feel free to take a look at those. There's a lot of wonderful resources about Jane Austen there. So Jane Austen was born on December 16th, 1775 in England, and she died on July 18th, 1817. And she, just to give a sense as to when she is writing, it's really during Regency era England, so the early 19th century here. And of course we are, that's also kind of, sorry, cord is messed up. Let's see if we can get there we go. Sorry about that. Cord was messed up. But this is also during the early Gothic period and into getting into Romanticism. So it's around that time. And just to give an example about what is influencing authors of this time period, we'll talk about Romanticism, which was really kind of a departure from the focus on logic and reason of the Enlightenment, and maybe even more so a focus on the individual and subjectivity and kind of what life means to individual people, high interest in art and philosophy, and also patriotism because of many of the revolutions taking place in both the United States and in France. And then also people taking stances on social issues, particularly the slave trade. So a lot going on during this time period. And then, of course, with Gothicism, we're seeing people enjoying getting scared and while they read. And we've got, you know, we've got in those pieces of literature, we see castles and monks and darkness and monsters and vampires. So all these kinds of things are influencing Jane Austen in her writing. Oh my goodness, Mr. Williams, it's so good.
I cheated.
How?
I did something dishonest. I worked through Charlie's account.
Oh, well, that's just fine.
He doesn't know it.
Do we have to call you Charlie today?
You can call me Mr. Montgomery.
Okay. Sounds good.
I'm not in my house, if you can tell. I'm not in a, it looks like I'm in a lineup. I'm in our breakfast room this morning and I'm PO'd with Zoom.
But I know. I'm so glad that you were able to make it. And we were just talking about the time period that Jane Austen was writing. So we know that we're in kind of Regency era time period, and we are having that she's would have experienced influence of Romanticism and Gothicism, and we can see that reflected in her work.
And we can see ourselves in her because she, in many ways, is a very modern woman, a very 21st century woman.
Absolutely. I didn't realize she was one of seven children.
Yes.
Yes, only one sister, though, Cassandra, who was also her closest friend. And I think when we see, we read her work, we notice that women are the protagonists, and
yes.
And women and their relationships with other women play a very big role as well. And so I wanted to also show on camera here, I've got our Austen pieces laid out. So I wasn't able, because we're having some scanner issues, I wasn't able to get all the scans I normally do, but I think this will work really well. So I wanted to show first this. I'm gonna go in order of the when these works were published. So this is our 1833 Sense and Sensibility. As you can see, it has some preservation issues, but this is hard to get. This is an early edition. Sense and Sensibility was originally published in 1811. And we've also got one from 1849 and in 1870. I will say that my favorite one is the 1833 because in there it actually has I can kind of show you here, a frontispiece, and it has some art, and has some illustrations on the title page and of course the frontispiece. And then it also comes with a memoir of Miss Austen, which is very, very helpful. So I was reading through that and I absolutely love that one. So I like that added. And that is one thing that's nice. At that time, by that time, Jane Austen had already passed away. So there was so the memoir was really, really interesting. It spoke of her legacy. And then we've got this beautiful 1894 Pride and Prejudice. And I do have some pictures of this that I'm gonna show when we talk about Pride and Prejudice. We've got in 1857, Mansfield Park. And this one was hard to find, right, Mr. Williams?
Very hard to find. Mm-hmm. And the nice thing about that one is that's a really great work because we collected some of the material such as Miss Edgeworth's play, which is featured in this book. Yes. Remember, the book had been performed until her father or her uncle came back and made him quit because it was too carnal. Because remember, the play is about a young woman who is unmarried and running around. And so I think this is important, Joel, just to put this in to say this is, Jane Austen was as well-read a woman you ever met, and she knew all the big people of the time, and she knew all their works. So she has Miss Inchbald in her books, which tells us she's a very, very modern woman. She understood, let me go back a minute. When I was a student, and that was not when Jane Austen was alive. Let me explain that to you. I am not that old, but nearly so. But people used to say Jane Austen's books were based on a part of a world that was not very sophisticated, that she didn't know about sex and she didn't know about slavery and she didn't know about all these things that we consider. Yes, she did. But she does it. She writes about them without writing about them. She puts them in context, such as, I just talk about Mansfield Park for a moment. Is the stories about a young girl who has to go live with her relatives. And the master of the household, I forgot what Sir, whatever his name is, the landowner has to leave to go to Jamaica to his plantations. Politest way you ever heard of saying sugar plantations, which means slavery. And he has to go down to deal with those. And then also she deals with, shall we say, the problems of young women, and you have to be very politic about this. She never mentions anything about babies out of wedlock, but you know, those things do happen. I'm surprised, in Pride and Prejudice, I'm surprised that Lydia didn't get in the condition before she got.
I know.
But the fact is there, Jane Austen is talking about the dangers of sex and of illegitimacy. And in Mansfield Park, the play by, and I forgot the title of it, Joelle, the play in Mansfield Park, where they are using what's called a reader's play, which means that she's very well knowledgeable about the latest fashions of society. People would perform plays in their community or their household without costume, and they would read the parts, but be very dramatic with them. And they were performing this play by Elizabeth Inchbald, mm-hmm. which dealt with, I don't know how to explain it, loose women. Did that make that clear? Loose women. Everybody understand me? Andrew, you don't know what that means, but everybody else does, I think. She deals with these things. So my point to you is that when we look at books like Mansfield Park and Pride and Persuasion, Pride and Prejudice, you're looking at a woman who very much looks at the 21st century.
Absolutely. And we're going to get a chance to talk about some of those themes. So you're right. She was well aware of everything that was going on around her. And she said it in, subtle ways.
Her best way of writing, this is something a writer ought to learn from her, is you don't have to have a sex scene to talk about sex.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I will say that one thing that I find interesting, another thing that you said was that she was well-read. And I think that's, it's very obvious in her novels because she does refer to plays and to other writers and you can see inspiration. So it's almost like she's having a conversation with some of her contemporaries, which would have included Fanny Burney, Mariah Edgeworth, Jane Porter, you know, Amelia Opie. And I want to read a little excerpt from from our 1833 Sense and Sensibility, from the memoir of Miss Austen. I thought this was really, really interesting. Let me see, I seem to have, did I lose the page? Let's see. I think I, oh, and Andrew, I see in this memoir, it says, talks about the pleasant village of Chawton. So perfect, thank you for that. Let's see. Okay. Let's see. Oh, I don't see it where I, I'll have to come back to it, but it, I don't even see it, but it talks about the, how she interacted with the, and how she, now I'm not saying that this is true, but it actually asserts that even though many of the contemporaries that we, that, you know, like Amelia Opie and Jane Porter and Mariah Edgeworth came before her, that she ended up becoming, I guess, the best of them all. And I think that's kind of a controversial statement maybe, but that's what her memoir in this 1833 Sense and Sensibility asserts. Okay, so let's see if we can go ahead and talk about her novels a little bit more in depth. The first one, as I mentioned, Sense and Sensibility, published in 1811. And if for those of you who are fans of Sense and Sensibility, I know Adina has read it twice. Do you want to tell us a little bit about your experience reading this wonderful novel, I absolutely love it, about two sisters with very different personalities. And do you want to tell us a bit about your first experience reading it and then how it changed the second time you read it?
Sure. So I was first exposed to Sense and Sensibility actually through the Ang Lee film in 1996. I guess the film premiered in 1995. It was the end of the year and I was looking back at it. And I think I went and I saw it for my 12th birthday. So with my dad, who's a huge Jane Austen fan. And, you know, it was kind of a formative experience in terms of the way the time period was portrayed and the relationships between the sisters. And I felt kind of in love with the period drama-ness of it, you know, as a 12-year-old girl, and decided to read the book. And at that time, it was my first exposure to the writing style that really is kind of in between an 18th century and a 19th century writing style, which I didn't realized at the time, you know, but it was definitely, the language was unfamiliar. It was the culture was unfamiliar. There were many things in the story that I knew were supposed to be humorous and which, you know, were portrayed that way in the film in a way that I could kind of understand. But when I actually went to try to read the story, a lot of it went over my head. And I persevered. I know I read the whole thing and I like talked about it with my dad and, you know, but at that time, it was very challenging for me, just in terms of how it was written. So I ended up rereading it, in college, actually at the tail end of an 18th century literature, English literature class that I took. And there it was kind of pointed out the ways in which Austen was transitioning from this outlook that was based on kind of logic and reason and, you know, this 18th century kind of outlook to the beginnings of romanticism. And that's a lot of what I feel like Sense and Sensibility deals with, you know, what one should do versus what one wants to do, and the role of individual desire, even within social pressures that are beyond your control. And in some ways, it's not completely clear which of the two sisters is meant to be the one that the reader should identify with the most. And I really liked that about the book. It was also just incredibly funny, you know, when you start to get into the her satire of everybody else, you know, including the main characters, but everybody else, nobody is beyond her scope in that sense of being rendered potentially ridiculous, which to me at least is still in part a holdover from the 18th century. Like that was a time when satire was incredibly common and powerful, and before you were sort of supposed to be more sensitive to the, you know, individual humanity of your characters. So anyway, I won't go on, but that was my experience with Sense and Sensibility.
That's so great.
That's a very good observation. But mm-hmm. You talk about her satire. Boy, you hit the nail on the head. Jane Austen, in all her books, employs satire, but Sense and Sensibility does a good job of it for this reason. Jane Austen almost always felt she was a part of society, but she was on the fringe of it. And she really did get P.O. for people. When she lived in Bath for a while, everybody loves Bath, me included. She didn't, because the people there were snobbish and they somewhat looked down on her. And I think when she saw people with their pretensions, even, so we say high-class people, she saw their pretensions, and she could skewer them without getting herself sued off the face of the earth, which I think that's the great indication of a superb satirist. You can say it, and it goes down pretty well with everybody except the person you skewer.
I love that, and I think one of the things that makes Austen's writing really unique is sometimes I've noticed that a lot of times she will begin chapters with satirizing someone but discussing them in such a matter-of-fact manner. It is so funny. Like in Sense and Sensibility, the beginning of chapter 8, she's talking about Mrs. Jennings, and she says, "Mrs. Jennings was a widow with an ample jointure. She had only two daughters, both of whom she had lived to see respectably married. And she had now, therefore, nothing to do but to marry all the rest of the world." So, I just love the way that, and it's just so funny. But it's so matter of fact, and that's what you see about Mrs. Jennings. Or I think that Adina's comment about not knowing which sister you're really supposed to identify with is also a great point. I particularly love this scene. It's earlier in the book, when you see, you know, for someone like me, I only have one sister. I have a little sister. So I think I feel usually pressured to be the one who is more responsible. And, but when I see the kind of the banter between Marianne and Eleanor, I think I naturally relate to Eleanor more as the older sister who has to keep everything together. But I love when they're talking about Edward, who Eleanor is really starting to fall in love with. She tries to be cautious with her words because she doesn't want to get her sister overexcited. She doesn't want to get her own heart overexcited. So she says, "I do not attempt to deny," said she, "that I think very highly of him, that I greatly esteem, that I like him." Marianne here burst forth with indignation. "Esteem him, like him? Cold-hearted Eleanor, oh, worse than cold-hearted, ashamed of being otherwise. Use those words again, and I will leave the room this moment." And it just reminds me of a little sister who's like, "Really? You're not gonna say more?" So, I just love the way she develops these relationships here. Those are just two of my favorite passages, but obviously everybody has their own. And so anyway, love
well,
it.
I'll tell you one little thing, which Nina mentioned the motion picture. Well, I saw that motion picture too. And the two sisters were having some tea. If you remember one of the scenes, they were sitting at a table having some tea. And they had the most attractive cups and plates with roses on them. They were very attractive. And one of the sisters, now I don't remember, but in the motion picture, one of the sisters makes some comment about them. So it makes you pay attention to them. It must have been a big deal. I thought, well, I watched the movie and I thought, I wonder what kind of dishes those were, because they look awfully nice and I like tea. So I watched the movie and then I sat through 10 more minutes of the after credits. I watched the last thing on the credits and it said dishes in the scene were from Ralph Lauren's Some Kind of Pattern. I went straight over to Rich's department store and I said, do you have this pattern? Well, they had four cups and four saucers and four tea plates, which I bought. So, and you know, the pattern, they must have thought that when they made that film, those dishes would be a big seller. They weren't. So they only had 1 year of production. So I have four of them. So if three of you want to come to tea, we'll have those. How about that?
Wonderful. Now,
tell me that's not a Jane Austen affectional statement.
That's great. That is great. So as y'all know, we're not going to get a chance to talk about every Jane Austen novel in just 50 minutes, but I wanted to go ahead and Adina said something very controversial in an email to me, and I actually agreed with her. She said that she actually prefers Sense and Sensibility over Pride and Prejudice. And I wanted to see if anyone felt the same way, or if I just said fighting words. So does anyone have a strong connection to Pride and Prejudice or a strong opinion about which one is better?
I like them both. I'm going to tell you, frankly, I have learned to like, and no, that's a bad choice of word. I have learned to respect Jane Austen more in Pride and Prejudice about the characters. So can I just mention one character?
Yes.
One character in Pride and Prejudice has always made me want to be murderous, and that's Mrs. Bennet. She is enough to drive you stark raving mad. And I thought that way for 40 years. But recently I have come to a different opinion. I still want to kill her. Lord, she lived in my house. I'm going to strangle her. You just come see me in the state prison. But on another side, I have a greater understanding of Jane Austen. Mrs. Bennet is the way Mrs. Bennet is, crazy as she is, because she is trapped. You realize she has no skills save to marry her daughters because she's going to have to go live with one of them someday. Her husband has an entail on a property because he does no male children, which must make Mrs. Bennet feel deep down somewhat she has failed, because when Mr. Bennet dies, they're going to lose the house and the income. And she's going to be, if her daughters don't marry well, and at the beginning of the story, they haven't done so, they might be on the street. And so I suddenly realized what Jane Austen's doing. She makes this woman so ridiculously awful. She just will not shut up. And can you just imagine that voice? Yeah, Mr. I mean, you just want to kill her. But you understand why she's that way. She's desperate. And so suddenly, I felt so sorry for her about 10 years ago. And I thought, Jane Austen is really, really perceptive. Now, that doesn't mean I don't like Sense and Sensibility. I certainly do. But there's nobody in that novel that I want to kill. And so, and the same thing is in Pride and Prejudice, the other person I despise. And if I didn't kill Mrs. Bennet, I would kill Lady Catherine de Bourgh. Because she is, without a doubt, I shouldn't say it this way, but she is one of the biggest snobbish bitches I have ever met. And I feel like I know her. But think about who she is. She's the daughter probably of an earl, because she's called Lady Catherine. She's a widow. She has a young daughter. Georgina is a pretty sweet young girl. God knows she's going to grow up to be an old maid, because nobody's going to marry her because they've got Lady Catherine to deal with. She is the most rude, obnoxious, disagreeable person you've ever met. She's the other end of Mrs. Bennet. You see, the point Jane Austen makes, I think, is women really are very often lost in society. They are dependent upon men. Now, she doesn't mean that, but that's how the world sees women. And Lady Catherine is just a titled Mrs. Bennet. So maybe if you, I would help the world out if I meet them and just kill them and or strangle them, and then we don't have to deal with them anymore. So, but, and that's one other thing. Now, Sense and Sensibility has a few scenes in there. I'd like to kick the sister sometimes. I only have one sister. So, but my sister, you said something about your sister, you know, you have the last word, but my sister would have the last word out the door. And then all of a sudden the door opened back and that head would peer around there and say, and something else she'd say, and then shut the door. So it's kind of like having two sisters at the same time. So I understand them, but I kind of begin to think that Pride and Prejudice is Jane Austen working out social mores in a way that we do not normally think. And it just took me 40 years. I'm kind of slow. It took me 40 years to do that.
Well, Stephanie put in a wonderful a YouTube video in defense of Mrs. Bennet.
I'm sorry for her now. I feel sorry for her.
Yes, you've changed your view on her. And I will say, even though I love Sense and Sensibility better, I will be hard-pressed to find a stronger sentence that starts a novel than in Pride and Prejudice, I will say. The famous, it is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. And we go from there. So I think that's probably one of the most captivating sentences you can start a novel with. But I wanted to jump toward one of her last novels, Persuasion. And I was so glad that Stephanie said that she wanted to kind of talk about what she likes about it. Because I feel like this is one that maybe we know of it, but I don't feel like it gets as much attention. So Stephanie, you want to tell us what you like about Persuasion?
Yeah, I absolutely agree that everyone talks about Sense and Sensibility and Pride and Prejudice and Emma, and that Persuasion doesn't really get its due. It's the last one that she wrote. It was published after she died. And it's kind of seen as like almost an adult fairy tale in a number of ways. It's, you know, it's a fairy tale kind of in the story. Her mother passed away. That's a very, you know, common fairy tale type trope. And she's an adult. The heroine in this book is the oldest of all of Jane Austen's. She's, oh my God, she's 27. I mean, and she says it like that, like, oh my God, I'm 27, as if, you know, that's the end of the world. But when you're, you know, at that time, if you weren't married at 27, that was, you know, a difficult thing. My husband actually bought me the Pride and Prejudice and Sense and Sensibility books. And I actually started by reading those and I had seen the movies. And then the Persuasion movie came out in 2007. It's with Sally Hawkins, who's in A Place for Water, is it? And Rupert Penry-Jones, who's an English actor. And I saw the movie first and then went to the book. And I'm glad I did, because I always find that as I reread, whenever I go back to reread Jane Austen, it takes me a little while to get back into the language to understand it. It's almost like reading in a different language and I've got to get back into the understanding of it. Hold on a second. But I feel like one of the things that I love and that's different about this book than any of the others is dialogue, or the lack thereof. If you think of, you know, in something like Pride and Prejudice, there's a lot of interaction with Lizzie and Mr. Bennet, and in Emma, they talk a lot, but there's almost no talking between Anne Elliot. So who here has read Persuasion? Anyone?
Oh, yes.
I have a while ago, but.
So not everyone has read this one. I would highly recommend it. It's a sleeper in the way that it gives you anxiety the way that the other ones didn't, because, you know, this is a story of Anne Elliot, who is 27 and unmarried and almost, you know, resigned to be a spinster aunt and just exist for the rest of her life. Like in Pride and Prejudice, her house, the house of her father, who's a vain baronet, is entailed to someone else. So, you know, we don't know what's going to happen with her. And so the idea, you know, there's themes of love and you know, housing and entailments and things like that. But, you know, persuasion and pride and determination are also the other big themes. And so the big theme in this book has to do with the persuasion of Anne, which is at 19 or 8 years earlier, she had met a dashing young naval officer they wanted to get married, and she is persuaded not to marry him. Mm. And then kind of by her, you know, godmother, who was a friend of her mother. But there are so many other slight persuasions that you see in the book over, you know, and as you reread it and rewatch it and think about things like that. And there's also self-persuasion that people are doing. Anne persuades herself later. I don't want to give anything away because, but you know, there's also pride is a big, the Elliot pride. It's something that's spoken of, almost with pride, that these people are prideful, but it's more so like with her father, that it's more vanity than it is pride. And with her, her pride is more, you know, determination is, mm-hmm. is hers. But you know, it's thought of as enviable, but it's not really. So there are all these almost and kind of things that you want to happen, and as you watch it. So in the book, it's so much, you learn so much about what's going on through Anne's internal thinking and narration, more so than, I mean, they almost don't talk at all until, you know, towards the end of the book. And so you're on pins and needles. And I think that's the part about it, you know, that I love so much. You know, she has an older sister and a younger sister. There's another gentleman that is going to get the house, Kellish Hall, where they live. You know, so there are all these things. Her older sister isn't married, you know, but her younger sister is. And, you know, all the things that these things mean. And then this Captain Wentworth, who is the man that she was engaged to, comes back into her life. And, you know, she's also trying to persuade herself that, you know, nothing's going to happen and that she's happy about that, even though she's not. She, you know, she's trying to, you know, there's persuasion of her trying to persuade her dad to go to Bath. So this also made me think that maybe Anne is based on Jane and her sister herself. She didn't like Bath very much. Neither of her sister even married. This was towards the end of her life, you know. So whenever I read it, I watch the movie at least once a month. It is my absolute hands down favorite. I could quote you from this movie and book all day long. And you know, just the way they describe Anne in terms of, you know, her early bloom, she was very pretty, but her early bloom is gone. And so she's almost become this kind of wilted flower, but there's such steadfastness to her. And she comes to determination kind of a long way around, you know, towards the end. So, I mean, it's a fairy tale. So, you know, that it's going to have a good ending, but it's not necessarily a happy story all the way through. Does that make sense?
It makes great sense.
Yeah.
I'm with you in the motion picture, Stephanie. The motion picture is so different from the other Jane Austen books.
Yes.
It is so, it is much more, they're all costume dramas and very attractive and rather bright. This one almost always has a cloudy day look to a lot of it.
Yeah.
And that, I think, is perhaps the most mature book Jane Austen wrote. And I find you're quite right. She has come to the conclusion how she can tell a story in her mind to the reader. I think she's great about that. She tells you so much without ever saying anything. She gives you the facts here, here, and here, and you have to supply the thoughts and emotions in the middle of it. Boy, you're good. You should be teaching Jane Austen.
Yeah, Steph,
you can. You're all really great. You are all really, really, Dina, you're very good about this too. You all need to do this. But I think that's a good observation about the film. I like that film too. It's different looking. It doesn't look like a Jane Austen film. It's much more mature, much more adult. Well, that's good. Boy, Joellen, you have really, really planned a good day.
Oh, well, I knew that the people that needed want to talk, but when I heard Dina and Steph wanted to talk, I was like, yes, because it's amazing hearing people's, I think, their personal experiences reading Jane Austen. Because whether or not you've read the book today, you know, the books we're talking about today, I think we can still, it's like amazing to see how different novels impacted, you know, different people and the experiences. And yeah, Steph, I'm now going to reread Persuasion because I don't think I got what I needed to get out of it when I read it before, clearly. So that makes me really excited. I wanted to share my screen and show you all something interesting, kind of moving from talking about the content of Austen's novels to talking about collecting Austen's novels. As you can imagine, collecting Jane Austen is a feat. You might want to bring some cash.
Bring a lot.
And I found this really cool. I think it was last year, a bunch of Jane Austen first editions came on the market at an auction at Swan Galleries. And that only happens once in a blue moon. And so they now have the catalog of what people paid for them. And I think that'll be kind of fun to look at because I was very interested to see what these, to kind of see what people were, what the value of these pieces are. And then also, I think you're going to notice something kind of cool about them. Oh, wait, I keep sharing my screen the wrong way. Here we go. I love looking at it. It's really, really great to look at catalogs of auctions, of different booksellers. So we have this. I mean, so we've got here Emma. Let's see, this one, November 2020. Let's see, this is first edition Emma. So
that's one of my favorite books, Joel, and I love Emma.
Do you want me to buy this for you?
Yes, would you get that, please?
Yep, sure. I'll get
$15,000. Yeah, that's probably reasonable.
Probably reasonable. Now, the interesting thing.
Did they sell Northanger Abbey on that one too?
Yeah, let's go down Mansfield. Here's Northanger Abbey. Okay, so this one was only, this was 10,000.
Okay. Now, see, that's her parody on a Gothic novel.
Yes, absolutely. So.
Oh, that's in good shape. Ooh, it I is like in good that. Shape.
So, Joellen, how many of these do we own?
Well, we own all of Jane Austen's six novels. We don't own the first editions, but we own, let's see, we've got three copies of Sense and Sensibility, one Pride and Prejudice, two Mansfield Parks, and then one Emma, one Northanger Abbey, and one Persuasion.
And what is our insurance value? Are they covered?
Oh, yeah, we've got our rare book collection. We do. We have fine arts insurance, so don't worry. We're taking
great. Good to know.
Yes, got them insured. Thank you, Kathy.
$75,000. Is that the first edition? That's cheap for first edition.
Oh, I know. This one wasn't there's one that, no, this one. I don't think this. Oh, it is first edition. But you know what? There's a more expensive first edition below. I don't know why. Let me show you the one that is the really expensive Pride and Prejudice. I didn't have a chance to see why it was, what did I do? Okay, this is the one that's sold for 100 grand. This Pride and Prejudice.
Oh, that's nice. I like. Can you get that?
Of course. Oh, yeah, this one sold for more. I don't know all the reasonings why.
Now, these are for auction, Joy. Auction prices will be very different from what a dealer would sell them for. Absolutely. And a dealer usually sell about three times that price.
Three times that? Wow. Yeah, so as you can see, and, you know, sadly, you know, it's funny because the ones that are like, it doesn't, you know, it's funny. I think, you know, we all kind of realize that Pride and Prejudice and Sense and Sensibility and Mansfield Park, maybe we're going to, you know, sell for more. Northanger Abbey and Persuasion. And those were published together. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Those are together. Now, is there something I want to know, the format of these? What do y'all notice about how these are, these first editions or these early editions and first editions? What surprises you about the format?
That they're broken up into like multiple books.
Absolutely. And that was standard during, that was a standard for the Victorian middle class during that time, because even though people would get, you know, work fiction through serials and maybe cheaper one volume reprints, this was a product of the, it was a practice that especially was used by private circulating libraries, which is how, again, the Victorian middle class got their reading material. And so the only thing was the publishers and the private circulating libraries couldn't agree on how much they were going to charge for each volume. So it fell out of favor. But then also there were other writers like Oscar Wilde who started to make fun of this format, because I think they kind of viewed it as trite and banal and not creative and just kind of predictable. And then some writers kind of started writing for the three volume format. So anyway, but this is how her novels during this time, because I think the three volume format really died in late 1800s. So it would have still been, you know, it would have still been.
You know, practiced. Joellen, the printing presses of the time didn't make it as easy to make or what we would call regular volume, because they would be thicker and harder to carry. Mm-hmm. And so the marketable business of breaking up in sections helped the lending libraries, which were principally bookstores. A good bookstore had its own lending department, and because they didn't have the public library yet. But it became the fashion to have three volumes all bound together. But then by the Dickens's time, 1850s, you began to find single volume books. People wanted to have that on the shelf. Mm-hmm. And it made it easier to purchase. But the reason for that one is, I won't wander off track here. By the time Jane Austen, we'll use her as an example, and of the lending libraries, the majority of book publishing depended upon a few newspapers and magazines to tell what was coming out. And so you went to the bookstore, or the booksellers they called them, or the lending library to see what was there. And the lending library would have two kinds of copies, the kind that had never been read, which, you know, there are always people who will never want anything that's been shop-worn. So they buy those new ones. But then when the lending library, the popularity waned, they would then bind them again and sell them, and they would be a little shop-worn, but they were cheaper. And so people liked those. But it made them, depended upon, like Dickens, it depended upon the railroads and the proliferation of periodicals through the railroads, which meant anything in London would be in the provinces. And I hate that word, because it was kind of looked down on people in Birmingham or Manchester. But everybody was able, where there's a railroad station, to get something down to read the paper and to hear the latest literature. And so major writers such as Lord Byron or Shelley, they were deeply hurt by the common press writing reviews about their works, which weren't nice, but it made for much better selling in the bookstores. As if that didn't go on today. It's right. Just on TV. Just think about it as a pre-Oprah book club. If you know, when she puts it on the TV, it sells a million copies.
Or even now, I think those conversations sometimes even take place on Twitter too. Well, you know, the right person tweeting about your book.
Twitter is makes my fingers hurt.
So how successful do you think they've been? I've noticed that these books are now also offered audio.
Yes.
So audio, you can do the audio version, and maybe more of the next generation is actually going to be using their devices.
Yes. And then right now, if you'll notice that in all the big newspapers online, all have at least once a week a big audible book reviews. And I'm going to tell you frankly, people, you're looking at the biggest affectionate user of audible books. I read those every week, and Charlie uses them too because he travels a lot. And we go through the list, and he chooses his, and I choose mine. And he has something called an Audible account rather than using on disc. And so we buy a dozen or two at a time and just go through. Yes, people, they are the biggest sellers for popular fiction in the world. Mm-hmm. They're making paper publishing. And I love them. A good reader, it'd be like Jane Austen's books or Charles Dickens. When people read them in the evening, somebody in the family read them out loud. Mm-hmm. We're going back to the way people used to read books.
Absolutely. That's a great point.
Let me add one word to that. Hallelujah. Yes,
absolutely. So I know we're past our time today, but I understand if you all have to go. But if you do have time to stick around for just a couple minutes, maybe till 11, Maggie, do you think you could do? Maggie created a little trivia for us about Jane Austen. So if you have time for just a really quick game, I think this will be fun.
Yeah. To hear Mr. Williams talk so highly of Stephanie and Adina and, oh, you guys should teach Jane Austen. I'm over here. I've never read a single Jane Austen book. And I'm like,
what did you say?
Okay, Maggie.
Maggie.
Stephanie will say, read Persuasion.
Yes. Well, go with.
Well, actually, I took a note. I think I'm going to read Northanger Abbey because you said it was a
gothic.
Yeah, you like gothic type literature. It's a mixed fun of the not gothic novel. It's funny.
Okay.
There. Can you guys see that?
Yes.
Okay. So the questions are probably super easy for people who already know stuff about Jane Austen. Even I knew this one. I mean, what is the missing word in the opening line of Pride and Prejudice? And I even knew this one, and I've never read any Jane Austen. But if you want to turn your mics on and just yell it out, feel free.
Acknowledged?
Yes, acknowledged.
Okay, so I was listening to something the other day that this is kind of like, even though this is like the most famous line, that is really irony because, you know, a single man in possession of a good fortune probably just wants a good time. He's not looking for it.
Exactly. That's what my husband always tries to remind when I'm like, oh my gosh, one of his friends is single. I'm like, he's like, just leave him alone.
Okay. So what book was Jane Austen writing at the time of her death? Watson's, Northanger Abbey, Persuasion, or Sanditon?
Is Sanditon?
Yes, it's her.
I was reading wrong, Sanditon. Interestingly, yes, that is true. That is correct. Yeah. Interestingly, some of the characters in Sanditon were hypochondriacs, and Jane Austen pokes fun at them at a time when she was suffering from something that would prove to be fatal. I just thought that was a little interesting note there.
And PBS actually did a Sanditon series.
Oh, I know.
About a year to a year and a half ago.
Loosely based.
Stephanie
did not appeal to me.
No.
Okay, number three. Which two books are partially set in Bath? And so this one might be a little tricky. I don't know. Northanger Abbey and Emma, Sense and Sensibility and Emma, Persuasion, Sense and Sensibility, Persuasion, and Northanger Abbey. Any guesses?
Oh, I don't know this one.
Persuasion and Northanger?
Yes.
Oh.
So Catherine Morland goes to Bath with the Allens in Northanger Abbey, and the Elliots retrench there because of debts and persuasion. Both of these books were published together posthumously, her first and last work. But also, the reason why I say it's a little tricky maybe is because in Emma, Mr. Elton goes to Bath to find a wife. And in A Sense and Sensibility, Eliza Williams disappears while in Bath. But none of the narration of the story is actually set there. So, All right. Which book begins the family of Dashwood had long been settled in Sussex?
Sense and Sensibility.
Yes. I told you, I thought these would be easier for you guys, definitely, if not all of them. Sense and Sensibility, interesting fact, is about Eleanor and Marion Dashwood. It was originally an epistolary novel called Eleanor and Marianne, and I had to look it up. An epistolary novel is a literary work in the form of letters.
Mm-hmm.
So it was correspondence back and forth between them, I guess.
So just like Dracula, right?
Yeah, that's in, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Except they're not really that way. They're letters, but they're really conversations in those stories. It's an 1860s class.
Yeah. Okay. What was Northanger Abbey originally called? Any guesses?
Susan.
Yes. Susan. Stephanie, you are...
I know. Stephanie, you're doing great. I didn't know that one.
Okay. So fun fact, it was originally called Susan and sold to a publisher under that name. Then it was changed to Catherine when another book was published with the title Susan. And then it was changed again to Northanger Abbey after her death. In Mansfield Park, what is Fanny's chief form of exercise? Riding, dancing, walks, no exercise. Anybody?
I remember Fanny being really, she was kind of, she had a lot of, I feel like it was either C or D.
Actually, no, it was A. It was riding. She rode the mare that Edmund got for her.
That's right.
Oh. I just remember her being like really just needy. So I thought maybe she
Does Jane Austen give any of her characters the name Jane?
No.
Yes.
Yes, the oldest Bennet sister is Jane.
Mm-hmm. No. Yes.
Two major characters are Jane Bennet, Elizabeth's older sister in Pride and Prejudice, and Jane Fairfax in Emma.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's important. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, which of these ladies plays the harp? Anne, Mary, Caroline, or Isabella?
Is the answer Bingley?
Mary Crawford.
Caroline.
Okay.
Mary Crawford was right. In Mansfield Park, Mary Crawford charms Edmund with her harp playing. The harp was a real status symbol. Anne de Bourges was musical. Isabella Thorpe was probably too poor. And Caroline Bingley may have played the harp, but it's never mentioned. Another young lady who does play the harp is Georgina Darcy. All right. Since her father was a clergyman, Jane Austen always portrayed the clergy as good, kind, upstanding people. Okay, so while some are good, such as Edmund Bertram, Edward Ferrars, and Henry Tilney, some are not. Mr. Collins is silly and toady, and Mr. Elton is vain, proud, and actually quite mean to Harriet. Okay, last one, guys. Which set of sisters are not very close friends? Louisa, Henrietta, Eleanor, Marianne, Anne, Elizabeth, Jane.
Anne and Elizabeth.
Ellen. Yes, that is correct. Elizabeth is proud and vain like her father, and Anne is sensible. All the other pairs of sisters are quite close.
Yay, well, that was perfect.
For you.
So I'm not going to take credit for making up those questions myself. I stole it from online, but we're not going to tell anybody that.
Yeah, you're allowed to do that.
That's what it's there for. Yay. Well, thank you guys so much. Thank you for staying late. That was just so much fun. It's, you know, when you're talking about like Jane Austen, you kind of have to allot a little bit of extra time. If anyone is a student in Dr. Katarina Gephardt's class, please send me an email and I'll make sure that you get your extra credit. But other than that, thank you all so much. And remember, if you have a book you really want to talk about for this classic literature unit, please let me know. I want to work it in. But anyway, I look forward to seeing you all next week. Bye.